She doesn't really like doing the press. She doesn't really...
Doesn't she?
No. It's not her. I know. Everybody loves doing it.
Oh, God. That's my favorite.
When you were a child, you dreamed that someday you'd be able to do more press.
Asking me what I think. Can't wait.
So do you remember your first interview?
Oh, yes, I do. Yeah. I was doing a student review and a comedy sketch stuff. And somebody said, Val Falloon wants to interview you, Michael's sister. You know, Michael Falloon was a friend.
Mm-hmm.
Val, I think I've met her. She wants to interview me. What's she going to do with it? Oh, I'm going to try and get into the newspaper. You know, so that was thrilling. Thrilling.
Yeah. And were you good at it immediately?
I can't remember. No, I didn't talk too much. Talked louder than that. You know, just... It was the novelty. It was flattered. I was flattered. Mm-hmm. You know, so.
So you came up as a comedian?
Sort of, yeah. You know, sort of a writer, actor, you know, kind of thing. Right, we were a sort of would-be Monty Python group.
Huh.
And there were two of us who principally wrote the sketches. And we were, at that stage, we went on from that auditioning for all the television stations, mm-hmm. networks in Sydney. And, you know, that was going to be our destiny. Then, while they were chewing on that, I went to England and saw Monty Python. It wasn't interesting. And I came back and said to Graham, I'm out. He said, why? And I said, the Pythons. He said, oh, you saw them, they're great. I said, they're brilliant, but they're so much better than we are. they're doing it. And we'll never reach that level. And anyway, it was rather bitter, you can imagine. He went on and the show was picked up and they paid me, but you know, for a period I thought, did I make the right move?
So is that your philosophy in work in general? I mean, do you want to be able to do it the best or not do it?
To be one of the best, yeah, at what you do. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's from a craft perspective.
Right.
So, yeah, if you're going to take something on, you know, why not aspire to do it as well as you can? You reach a point where you're straining against your own limits. I mean,
right.
You know, you can only go a certain distance without phenomenal luck, probably.
Well, does it change as from project to project, depending on what the boundaries are? I mean, is it really ultimately come down to your limits?
No, if you just take, you know, as the decades pass, it's really story by story. So, you know, you want to feel at the end of, at this stage, you know, that you have left that project with, you know, everything done that you thought was right for it.
But if you do something like Master and Commander versus something like Fearless,
yeah,
the technical side of Master Commander seems much more daunting on some level, but the emotional side of Fearless actually seems almost is a richer, deeper pudding in some ways. Is that different muscle groups that you carry, or is the stuff that's more craft oriented and getting that right easier for you or different?
Well, you know, one of my first films in Sydney, a half hour film in the 60s, I wrote that the opening scene was the scene of a revolution in the streets of Sydney, a contemporary revolution of, you know, armed young Marxists or whatever. And you know, that was it. You know, and it was then a film within a film when people came out of the cinema and they were the actors. And I didn't ever think, could we do it or will we do it? We just had to do it. You know, that was a necessary scene for that movie, and we did do it. We got permission. We closed streets. And we got a tank. And we got blah blah blah. So I think, you know, if the story requires something, the only thing you then look at is, does it have, if it's going to cost money, does it have the scope to reach a wide audience? And if it doesn't, then you can't go ahead. But if you think it does, then, you know, it matches the potential reach. Master and Commander, pretty straightforward, you know, adventure story, but in an unusual setting and period, which was terrific. But, you know, I thought that was something that would be in the multiplexes. But then that's not all I'm interested in. So then, you know, I get bound up in this story or in Fearless. And so you craft the thing and check the budget, you know, because you know it's going to reach a certain distance. And make sure you think you're reasonably, you know, in tune with that possibility.
So is it for you about at least making your money back so that you can make the next movie? Or do you care
money
about
money back and $1. For some reason, I've always thought as long as I made $1. Yeah. You know, it's what's wonderful about it is, you know, is it's a, you know, despite changing market and scene now, it's a living, breathing art form. It's not subsidized. It's not in museums. It's alive, and that you know, presents challenges and things, but above all, it's a, you know, it's an entertainment, it's an industry. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you, if you want to go out and entertain, then you have to take in a lot of these factors.
So how did The Way Back come to you?
It was sent to me as a book.
Uh-huh.
And I got completely hooked up in it. But I think that's also because as a kid, I was, you know, I'm sure it's lots of kids, but loved adventure stories. You know, I mm-hmm. loved, you know, Jack London. I loved true stories like Shackleton.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've seen every kind of incarnation of Shackleton.
And there were a lot. That was that year.
Yeah,
there
yeah.
were three or four of them. And
there's another one planned,
really?
As far as I know.
Huh.
And our own country, you know, being an ex-colony like yours, you know, mm-hmm. it was, you know, they were explorers, and you know, you knew all about them at school.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was always in your mind the idea that you go out into the outback and the desert, you know, looking for, you know, exploring the, mm-hmm. the countryside. So that was already within me, I think. So that when this story came, it was very appealing.
So what were you doing in the years before it came to you? Do you just kind of do whatever you're doing and wait for something great or something that rings the bell? Or
no, it was just a curious period of, for me, of quite a few false starts. There were three mm-hmm. pictures I worked on at script stage. And they were all studio pictures. But one thing, you know, one of them didn't, I wasn't happy with the script. Another one, I, you know, there were disagreements about the direction of the script.
And, mm-hmm.
you know, they just didn't happen. And none of them do I regret. They shouldn't have happened. They were, mm-hmm. you know, right to be abandoned, at least by me. And then number four, you know, mm-hmm. so that took up a few years, you know, including in one case surveys and, you know, travel.
Frustrating.
Well, like you sort of roll with it, you know, because mm-hmm. it's, you know, I love analogies, and I sometimes think one I'd like is because you do so much flying. I like the idea of the pilot and the plane, you know, so I love all of that. You know, so you're in the cockpit, you're planning a journey.
Mm-hmm.
It's dangerous. It's a newly designed aircraft or something, and you get a lot of red lights on the panel, and there's no way you're going with those mm-hmm. lights on. And so that's it's a lovely analogy for scripts. Or people you're working with who become red lights and you say, I'm not flying this thing.
So did you ever fly with the red lights on?
No, I've had them come on as you are flying. What the hell is that? We're going to go down. Quick, you know, let's get to a little, what is it, the script? Is it the, you know, you've got to drop that scene? What are we going to mm-hmm. do? We're running out of money, whatever.
But you knew from pretty early on that you were self-possessed enough to say no when, as opposed to just moving forward because you could.
Yeah. I mean, it's like when people say, did you ever regret not doing a film that went on, someone else didn't became a hit? And I say, no, not at all. You know, it's their film, but it's not mine. You know, it's mm-hmm. and it may be good, you may enjoy the other person's film, but it's something about it. When you're ready to do something and it's right, I've never mm-hmm. been stopped, but I have stopped a lot of films or mm-hmm. turned them down. Because they simply, I just wasn't well matched to it. And if you're not well matched, I mean, anybody can say action and cut.
You know? Right.
And some of the best don't even say that. I watched Hitchcock. He did say cut. He didn't say action. The first said that.
Mm-hmm.
And he said one word, cut. The most important word.
Yes.
You know, he could say stop. He could say nothing, you know.
Of course, with digital these days, some people don't like to say cut ever.
No, that's true.
They go on and on
just
and on.
Just in case, yeah.
So you get the book and you're intrigued. You go
yep.
mm-hmm. thinking childhood. And was it set up somewhere, or was it moving along at all?
No, it was an independent film. And, you know, they were just hoping that my coming into it would trigger something. So I said, you know, I wanted to work on the script and I wanted to fictionalize it.
Mm-hmm.
The book has a different title called The Long Walk, and it mm-hmm. was under a cloud ever since it was published. The man who wrote it said a true story.
Mm-hmm.
And large chunks of it are, you know, according to documents, true. You know,
right.
A man who was in the Polish army in the war, he was captured, he was imprisoned in a gulag, he was mm-hmm. tortured. But according to documents revealed, he didn't escape. He was released with others in the amnesty and made his way to Poland and joined the Polish army, the Anders army. And so I nearly abandoned the thing because I'd always been wary of biographies and true stories.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I do them, I have to totally believe it, and I couldn't change anything.
Right.
I can't understand how people can unmarry famous people or give them children when they didn't have it or change facts or leave things out. So I'm not a guy for that, and I'm a fiction guy. So I said, look, if you let me fictionalize it, and what we do know for true and we have proof of is that several men came out of the Himalayas having walked from Siberia. And so I'm comfortable we dedicate the film to them, but then I'm free to make up a character like Colin Farrell played, you know,
right.
a convict and an Urca, rather. One of the kind of mafia guys.
So did you do a lot of research on those guys?
Yes, you know, I went to all the locations, went to Russia, you know, went and interviewed people who had done time in the gulags. Ordinary folks that were just knock on the door at 3 a.m. and you're under arrest. And they were political prisoners. Then in London, met Polish people who had been prisoners during the war. And of course, you know, there was fantastic information which I fed into the script, and very susceptible to locations. So, you know, went to Mongolia and to Siberia.
Are you a research junkie? Is that one of your things?
Yeah, I think so. Master and Commander, you know. There was a fantastic field of research. And then there's a point you want to leave it behind. And I'm always careful then when you hire the expert, the advisor, who will be with you, that they're not a certain type of academic that is too rigid, you know, can create, you know, kind of mayhem. So you want someone who understands a bit about how film is made, plus they're an expert, so that they say, as we say, you could cheat that. That's okay, you know. Or we could, you could leave that out. Flexible and, you know, inventive.
So you've always had a great interest in ethnicity and particularly indigenous people around the world.
Well, not you know, my interest is purely in stories. I can't get enough of them. Rather than subject matter. You know, sometimes they'll ask me here, what are you looking at? Do you like Westerns or do you like this, that and the other? I say I don't have any prejudice against any particular type of story, but, you know, I just love a good tale. Which goes back, what, your childhood, you know.
Is there anything you haven't shot that you would like to shoot? Is there anything like that where you go, I'd like to try a Western, I'd like to try a musical?
No, I don't think, a musical, no. I don't think that I really want to do a musical. No, I how do you start them singing? But I've loved musicals from the past, but no, it's never drawn me, but there could be a subject for some reason. You know, a group of monks, you know, or something, who sing some interesting music that has a secret contained in the Latin, you know, or something, but not a normal musical about that.
So you went along with this picture, you guys worked on the script, and so were you still looking for funding, or it was not funded?
There was a point where I was happy with the draft, and that was, you know, 9 months' work. So I passed that over to the co-producer, Johnny Levin, and to our... the man, John Patak at Arsenal, who was to raise the money. He showed it round and we had a number of contestants. And in, at that stage, we, you know, it was just before the big crash, we could choose. We chose who we thought was a good match.
So you had the money that you wanted to work with?
Eventually, yeah.
Because one of the things that was particularly notable for me, and I actually thought that Ramir Real was missing at one point, was the trip over the Himalayas.
Yeah,
is not really portrayed in the film, and I kind of wondered if that was a financial hole
we could have done it, but no, it was, you know, it's enough traveling. It's enough. Yeah.
It's a lot of traveling.
It's a lot of traveling. Yeah, we don't need to see that.
So, what is your process when you start with the, trying to cast a movie like this?
Well, you know, I always think casting is rather like being a detective, you know, and in the Missing Persons Bureau, and a number of people will come in claiming to be the character. And they will lie they're through their teeth saying that it's me. And you have to decide who it really is. And I find it a fascinating process. And in this case, I not only had to get, you know, the right people, multiple nationalities, but people that I sensed were going to be good on a journey because we were going to be in these kind of locations. So I needed, you know, what they call, I guess, team players. And I had to say to them that unlike most films where if you've got a smaller part, you're in maybe four or five scenes, you're going to be on camera for most of the movie, but you won't have any dialogue. So understand there'll be days where you'll wonder what you're going to do. And you've got to come up with your own stuff. You know, think about where you slept. You know, does your neck hurt? Do you, you know, did you tear your trousers? Are you trying to repair them? if it's by the campfire. And don't worry about where the camera is, because you know all of you will get your moment.
Mm-hmm.
And that we didn't have anything but cooperation from the actors from the start. Of course, they understood that.
So is there a certain kind of actor who cottons to that, who wants to take that journey? Do you think maybe they just want to work with Peter Weir and it's an opportunity to finally do that, and they're willing to put up with whatever the circumstances?
I don't know entirely, because I don't think of myself, you don't think of yourself much. It's just, yeah. You know, you're auditioning for the job and you get the right people. I got the right people. Casting, you know, here and in Berlin.
I've always had the feeling Ed Harris would walk through fire for a director he believed in.
Well, we'd had a very good experience on The Truman Show.
Yeah.
And, you know, as you do tend to say, you know, maybe there's another one out there.
Mm-hmm.
But many years passed, and then, you know, suddenly this seems just right for him.
Mm-hmm. And Colin has not been known for his discipline, but it seems like he...
Well, what
put it, got it together here and really...
Oh, the discipline, you know, he learnt, I don't say learnt Russian, but he mastered it, enough of it to go mm-hmm. beyond just doing an accent so that, you know, he was convincing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so much so that when someone said to me recently, a journalist said, what was his process? He was so convincingly Russian. I said, oh, didn't you know he is Russian? It was... you know, Farolansky, and the family moved to Ireland when he was 5 years old. And she said, she was writing it down, and I said, look, no, I'm just kidding. But they said, I said, well, it really got you.
It'd be a good story.
Yeah, that's true.
And Saoirse, I can't even, it's hard to think of many young actresses who can do what Saoirse does.
Yeah, yeah. What is that ability to have it so young? And she could do, you know, scenes with, you know, of emotion, and then step off and be bright and young, and then step back into her character. It's like the opposite of the method. And I think it's like being born with a talent.
And then you see her in real life, and she seems usually like a teenager.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fascinating. Yeah. It's like...
It is. You've met her.
A few times, yeah. Mm. You don't quite expect it.
Delight. No, you don't. You know, and I sometimes chat with the parents and say, where does it come from? But, you know, there's no answer to that. Her father's an actor, and but she just, and she's not a show business type, as you know. So it's also, they live out of Dublin and live a, you know, reasonably kind of quiet rural life with sudden trips to exotic places.
Big trailers.
That's right.
Do you have trailers in a movie like this? How does this work?
We started with trailers. Then as the journey began, the trailers were around the studio, but then as we went along, they'd say things to me like, could you share it with production tomorrow? And I'd say, of course, you know. So we tried to keep something close by. I mean, we didn't camp out. You know, this was, they needed reasonable comfort in order that people were fit and well enough to do their job, you know, so they weren't just exhausted. But no, we didn't. You know, most of the time, it was too far back to the camp. And so the guys would say, I'm going to stay here for the lunch break. You know, or I'd rather stay here. I mean, Ed Harris very much influenced everybody. He to a great extent, lived the character. And he made a lot of his own props. And he would be off by himself scrounging stuff on location, finding bits of wood and shaping them into things. And not getting into a kind of buddy joke anecdote kind of group. And I don't have a lot of video village. There's no replay fun.
Right.
So that it was kept quite realistic. It wasn't hard to be there.
Right.
Really.
Huh.
Even the set, even the camp, the gulag we built in the back lot. And given the weather conditions, snow, it wasn't hard to feel it. And then given all the research and the details, in the work on the details, you know, of sets, costumes, makeup and everything, and with our experts, we went as close as you could to giving a realistic feel of this story.
So was it a very different experience with Ed, given that the first movie he's pretty much in a room on a set the whole time? Here you're up in the middle of...
Different challenge, you know, no one thing's any easier or harder than another. You know, that had its own challenges and interest and difficulties and excitements, and same with this. You know, it's just a different job.
Have you had a picture where you've been this spread out? How far, I mean, what was the range of where you guys were traveling. How many different locations? How many different?
Well, firstly, we had three countries. We had Bulgaria, Morocco, and India. But locations within those that were standing in for other, you know, for China, right. for example. Yeah, so mountains and rivers and lakes, you know, they were all in different parts of the country mm-hmm. we were in, you know, particularly in Bulgaria had the, obviously, kind of European locations. Mm-hmm. And Morocco, there was quite a, you know, journeys here and there from where there was a river going then deep into the Sahara to mm-hmm. to the dunes. So that one of the challenges and difficulties of it was what time you could start shooting.
Hmm.
Whether we were very fortunate, because that was my first concern. And I said, look, there is no weather cover once we leave the camp.
Right.
We're in continuity. Whatever weather we get has to be the weather of the scene.
So you shot in continuity? You shot in
more or less, yeah. Mm. Mm. At least with the big blocks.
Mm-hmm.
Started in the camp and ended in India.
Mm.
But it was getting to the location with enough of the day left, you know, so I had to be very disciplined to not choose something that was, you know, more than an hour and a half from base as a drive.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, sometimes you had to go a bit further.
Is that in and of itself exhausting? Just getting from base to, you know, spending an hour and a half in a car?
Adrenaline trumps exhaustion. It's amazing what you can do. If they could sell, talk about heroin and other drugs, if they could sell adrenaline, you know, we'd have a real problem.
Yes.
There's nothing like it. It just gets you through things in life, whenever they can imagine situations of that. Wartime, probably.
Yeah.
People got sick when the war was over, you know. People have been in headquarters anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So, and look, it's true of a film. You know, you just beset by all, you know, the difficulties that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And discoveries, but you're just so charged, I think, that exhaustion can wait in line.
Amongst the emotions. Well, I mean, has it changed since you've become more than 39? Is it wear on you differently?
Yes, it's a bit easier. I think there's nothing harder than the first film. I mean, I look back to that 29-year-old kid who made that first film and remember myself then thinking, how do people do this? You know, I was a month shooting.
Mm-hmm.
I was just
a whole month.
Dead. Yeah,
a whole
month. I was dead. And I've never known such exhaustion in my life and slept for days afterwards. And the point is you become professional. You know, you learn how to take shortcuts. And if you're lucky enough to have a long career, you can gather about you people who are very good at their jobs, both in front and behind the camera, you know, to make sure that you are not expending energy on something that you know that you did when you were young, because you were, you know, kind of pollinating all of the flowers. You know, you were just couldn't trust anybody. And you had to be there, you had to do it yourself. You know, I'll make some props, or I'll paint the set. Oh, it was fun, but
I'll paint the set. Did you paint the set the first time out? Was that part of your?
I don't
your list of credits.
It was about motor cars, so I did buy a car and drove it to set. And yes, you do everything. You know, you've got to learn every job.
Of course, there's the old joke about Jerry Lewis that he's writer, director, star, producer, light, camera, car, whatever was there was him.
Yeah,
and that was the only way it is. Yeah. So aging is not an issue for. I mean, they say the director's legs go first. Because all that standing around all day, I guess.
Yeah. I don't, you know, I wonder how long one can keep going. I'm fairly lucky. I did injure myself in the film. There was a period, the doctor said you should really keep off this leg, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was my knee, actually. But, you know, how could I do that? And he said, well, try and keep on level ground. I said, okay, we're just leaving for Morocco in the morning. Then on to India, to the below Nepal. And he said, what? so that was one thing. But I got through that. They made a kind of sedan chair for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there were four Bulgarians who would carry me two in front, two in back.
Huh.
Like some sort of, you know, 19th century explorer. You know, I'd arrive on set like this. The actors thought it was hilarious.
It seems so you.
Put me down here.
Give me another crepe.
Here are some notes. Okay, take me back. They did. They laughed, which was a bit unfair.
A giant speaker. Well, does it change? I mean, is it harder to do a movie that's on a stage than do a movie like this?
It's hard to do a movie when the script isn't right.
That's all it really
is. It's hard to do a movie when you cast the wrong actor. Mm-hmm. But if you've got those key things right, yeah, then it's simply just whatever challenge that movie presents. Mm-hmm. I mean, I like to think, you know, I told you I loved analogies, so forgive me. But it is, you know, mountain climbing currently, mm-hmm. I love, which, and I'm particularly interested in that disastrous 1996 expedition series of deaths on Everest, mm-hmm. where two or three very experienced guides died, made fundamental errors, mm-hmm. In what time they left the mountain or whatever.
Right.
And that's awful to link a tragedy to what we do. But, you know, I'm an experienced guide, an experienced storyteller, mm-hmm. and each story is a mountain. And each one is dangerous and thrilling. But you can make that mistake. You can make that error. And, you know, mm-hmm. the film goes down, you know, and you don't get it. But if you do feel you got it, if you did what you set out to do, mm-hmm. then you accept fate, I think, which can, unfortunately, sometimes be, you know, that you die at the box office or, right. you know, you get negative reviews and people don't like it. But, you know, that's ouch. But right. if you did what you wanted to do, then you really can't complain.
So you keep all that stuff in mind, but it's not the, what you do on that stage and what you do in post and what you, yeah. the work you do yeah. is really yeah. everything for you ultimately.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
So, I mean, like one of the movies that I always have a conversation about is Mosquito Coast, which is one yeah. of my beloveds yeah. that some people still, you know, are frustrated by and
yes, I know.
Can't quite, yeah. and it's kind of like, you just didn't get it, like figure it out. Yeah. Is it frustrating for you when something like that happens? I mean, you have a big movie star, you have all those elements, and then it just doesn't
initially,
take off?
Initially, yeah. I think that, you know, any director would say that, you know, that when it's just, you know, from almost the early interviews, mm-hmm. and that was the case with that film. I think it was a woman I sat with, and she was quite friendly and pleasant, mentioned a couple of earlier films of mine. Mm-hmm. So everything seemed fine. And she said, I have to say this right off. You know, I don't know why the Harrison Ford character's wife would have gone with him. I would have said, no, I'm not going with you. And I thought, well, what? You know, but it's not about you. You know, but then I right. realized a number of other women were annoyed by him as a mm-hmm. husband or something. You know, so and then other cracks began to appear. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, this is just going to go down. You know, I have mm-hmm. to go down with it.
And did it feel like that, or were you still running off the high from other movies that you kind of moved on to the next thing?
I moved on, but, you know, I think you remain perhaps overly fond of them. Mm-hmm. Analogy number three. The director's movies are like children. Mm-hmm. And you know the ones you're most fond of are those naughty ones or those ones that have a failing. Mm-hmm. Sometimes not the bright ones that do well in sport or work, you know, but those mm-hmm. little troublesome ones and the ones that only you can love. Mm. And so those films like Mosquito Coast, you know, remain very close to you, mm. I think, in a strange way.
And do you have that perspective? Do you have a career perspective at this point? Do you
no.
think about any of it?
No, this was the only thing I had on this afternoon, was coming to see you. I've got no scripts, so I've got maybe one
I mean, do you think of, okay, I did this, you know, 30 years ago, and was fantastic and loved, and, you know, this is the arc of my career. Is that even
No, I never think of arcs, careers, mm-hmm. ladders. Only success or failure for the story. I must get the story right. Mm-hmm. Back to the mountain, climbing it, you know, and looking for another mountain to climb, looking for another story. Mm-hmm. They consume me, you know, it consumes me. You heard more stories when you traveled slower. Mm-hmm. It's a pity we don't travel by ship, you know, particularly living in Sydney, mm-hmm. because on board a ship journey, I would hear some stories, people talk mm-hmm. when they're isolated. Flying back on the 747, the person over there, you don't talk to them, and they'd die if you said hello. You know, everybody wants to stay, you know, plugged into their
Now they have the computer. Even on the back of the seat, they have, you know, the movies and everything.
Yeah.
Don't even have to say hello to anybody.
But I first traveled to Europe by ship. Traveled around the Mediterranean by ship, and I got 3-4 stories from it. Mm. I've only ever made one into a film, but I carry them with me, and I'll write them down as short stories one day.
Is the greatest challenge of this particular film telling that much story in movie length?
I think it's rhythm in it. You know, I was aware that I didn't want to exhaust the audience. I didn't want them, they don't have to take the walk, but I wanted them to believe the characters had. Mm-hmm. So some cuts it was too long, too much. and some too short. You know, it seemed mm-hmm. like, wow, you know, they didn't really, you know, suffer. So getting the rhythm right consumed my attention during the cutting period.
Mm-hmm. Mm. It's a long journey.
Yeah, 4,000 miles, yeah.
It's a hard way to go. I mean, it's a tough road, but it seems like people are getting enormous amounts of love for this movie.
Well, yeah, let's hope, because with the hardness comes the, you have to have it tough, come back mm-hmm. to Shackleton, in order for the feeling of human beings overcoming that difficulty. I think if you have a movie, it's very difficult with a film, I think, in which people suffer, and then there's nothing, it's unrelieved.
No relief,
they go down. And there are some films which are very fine, but very small audiences, because it's just too hard to take. But stories where they come through it,
mm-hmm.
I think, you know, is a type of film that has been around for, or story for a long time.
And when you're a Telluride showing the movie and not sure what's going to happen in the future, is that the relief at the end of the journey for you?
Yes, I think when you start talking uh-huh. and somebody, you realize that things you've done are coming back to you. People felt things you put into, particularly feelings.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I had a certain feeling about this story, and I've put that feeling in the film. So what you'll feel is what I felt and what drove me to make it. That's mm-hmm. quite apart from the visual side of it, but how you feel when you come out at the end is what I mm-hmm. sums up 2.5 years of my work on the film. And I'll sometimes rate myself. I'll think, out of 10, what did I get?
Hmm.
How much of that feeling that I had is 10 out of 10, because it's in here or here. And what did I get? You know, so I'm happy if I get around 8, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You never get 10.
And does that change over time? Do you look back, do you think back, okay, that movie really was a 7 or really was a 9 and I thought it was an 8?
No, I'm pretty right with the first.
You know what it is for you.
I think what you learn later, and that can be even in a period like now, like 6 months later after, or 12 months after shooting it,
uh-huh.
you can understand why you chose it.
Hmm.
You chose it because I said it was a good story, but there's sometimes, always in fact, other reasons you took it, unknown mm-hmm. to yourself. I think unconscious drives.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes through this kind of weird, you know, ersatz therapy, talking to you, the doctor.
Please let him.
You know, can I talk about my film? You know, you come to realize certain things that you would have seen that with insights mm-hmm. directors have got, or writers, about why they, mm-hmm. what it was that made them pick that subject up.
So we'll have to talk again in 2 years and
that's right.
See what this movie was really all about.
That's right. Get way back. Let's go back.
That's right. Back to the way back.
Yeah.
After you've made Avatar 3, which I'm sure you'll.
Well, you know.
It's so you.
You know, it's. Go and talk to Jim.
I'm still waiting for the sequels to all your movies. Witness 2.
They'll die with me.
And Mosquito Coast 2. And all of them. Those should all come back.
Whatever happened to those people?
Fearless 2. He gets allergic again. That's me. The comedy. It'll be the rom-com version. Fearless 2, allergic again. He and Rosie will shack up. It'll be great.